tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Bah, humbug!
Uncle Dan.
It's enough to drive a man to drink.
Give me a little finissimo, Professor, please. I would like to speak a few words on temperance. That's fine. Keep it down there. Ladies and gentlemen, down with rum. Ever since the beginning of time, there has been a drink problem. Quite a problem. Even a greater problem now. It's so scarce. Throughout the Middle Ages, the use of liquor was universal. And drunkenness was so common, it was unnoticed. They called it the Middle Ages, because no one was able to walk home unless they were between two other fellows. I was usually the middle guy. But through the years, enlightenment came, and with it the control of spiritus fermenti. And controlling spiritus fermenti is tougher than tying a hair ribbon on a bolt of lightning. That's a good simile. But how well I remember my first encounter with a devil's brew. Devil's brew. I happened to stumble across a case of bourbon. And I went right on stumbling for several days thereafter.
Hello, this is Paul Merton. Sorry if I've interrupted your post-turkey snooze. You've just heard the unforgettable voice of the man who dared to say he hated Christmas and, by a twist of fate, died on this very day 50 years ago, December 25th, 1946, W.C. Fields. In the true Scrooge spirit, he declared the festive season to be humbug, and I know exactly how he felt. We're going to celebrate W.C. Fields' jaundiced view of life and hear from others who share his outspoken attitude.
He was Dickensian. I think there's something wonderful about people who are that rude and get away with it.
Fields did have this wonderful attitude, and very strong, which made him stand out.
He'd lift your spirits a lot. If you were able to call him Uncle Claude, that means he accepted you. Each time I would go to his place, like going into this wonderful... a hidden wonder world. It was like peeking at your Christmas presents because there's some wonderful surprise inside.
A few thoughts there about the great man. More from that lot later. Fields' first biographer, Robert Louis Taylor, made some important points about him.
Fields was the only authentic humbug of his generation. There's a wide difference between the real blown-in-the-bottle variety and the fake humbug. He had a genuine distaste for the principal horrors of civilization, stuffed shirts, aggressive women, restrictions on drink, noisy children, and middle-class morality, and he fought these brilliantly within the limits of his medium. The rascal got the girl and the money. Sanctimony wound up in the ash can. In his small but raspy way, he caused hypocrisy just as much grief as he could, and he probably did more to retard the onward march of blue-nosism than any other American.
I think what Fields really despised was those people who celebrate Christmas for all the wrong reasons. That scathing satirist Tom Lehrer sums it up so well in his barbed Christmas carol.
Christmas time is here, by golly, disapproval would be folly. Deck the halls with hunks of holly, fill a cup and don't say when. Kill the turkeys, ducks, and chickens, mix the punch, drag out the dickens. Even though the prospect sickens, brother, here we go again. On Christmas Day, you can't get sore. Your fellow man you must adore. There's time to rob him all the more. The other 364. Relations, sparing no expense, send some useless old utensil or a matching pen and pencil. Just the thing I need. How nice. It doesn't matter how sincere it is, nor how heartfelt the spirit. Sentiment will not endear it. What's important is the price. Hark, the Herald Tribune sings, advertising wondrous things. God rest ye merry merchants, may ye make the Yuletide pay. Angels we have heard on high, tell us to go out and buy. Let the raucous sleigh bells jingle, hail our dear old friend Kris Kringle, driving his reindeer across the sky. Don't stand underneath when they fly by.
Tom Lehrer. I'm sure Fields would have enjoyed that irreverent gem. I think Les Dawson had a lot in common with Fields. This is what he said about him in a Radio 4 documentary nearly 20 years ago.
Comedy's introduced us to many eccentric figures, but none more flamboyant than W.C. Fields. Books have been written about him, records issued, and his life story has been filmed. His nasal bray is the stocking trade of many an impressionist, but Fields' original films aren't as well known as they deserve to be. For some people, Chaplin, Keaton or Laurel and Hardy are the classic screen clowns. My choice is Fields. His unsentimental outlook appeals to me. I think his comedy of frustration is perfectly in tune with our time.
And I'll drink to that. How do we know so much about W.C. Fields' sentiments towards the so-called season of goodwill? Ronald Fields, the comedian's grandson and biographer, gives us the family viewpoint.
For the most part, during any time of the year, the entertainers were always invited to someone's home until Christmas. And that's when the people, of course, they wanted their families together, not necessarily some stranger who was playing on the local theater. So the vaudevillians were always spent Christmas or most holidays alone, and they learned to resent it that way.
Author Gene Fowler was one of his closest confidants, and here's his son Will.
Pop and I were over to his house on Christmas Day in 1940, and he was sitting alone, and he would yell at his butler if he heard any Noel music. He would on the radio, he'd throw the radio and the butler out. So Pop said, "Come on, Uncle Clay." He says, "Why do you hate Christmas, really?" He says, "Well, if you really want to know," he says, "you know, when I'm on the road as much as I used to be," he says, "at Christmas time, I'm very lonely." He says, "being lonely is the worst thing in the world." He would see the Christmas lights in other people's homes, and he had no one to talk to. And he said, "everyone's lonely at some time in their life." And he gave us a big bound book when we left, and he said, "Here," he says, "open this when you get home." So we opened the book when we got home, and it was the big Los Angeles telephone directory. He says, "places where I'm not wanted." And then he, of course, gave us a Christmas card. He made a lot of his Christmas cards himself, but only to special friends.
I've always wanted to create my own Christmas cards. I thought like a painting of a humbug on the front of it and just send it out anonymously to people. Perhaps people I don't even know, so they wouldn't ever know who it was from then. Fields once said that he used to believe in Christmas until he was 8 years old. But after delivering ice in his hometown of Philadelphia and saving his earnings to buy his mother a present, he caught his father stealing the money. Fields decided then and there he'd remember nobody at Christmas and expect nobody to remember him. "Sleigh bells give me double nausea," as he put it. "That two-faced merriment monger Santa Claus who passes you by," he said. It made him feel like either taking a drink or shooting all the Santa Clauses infesting all the boulevards in Hollywood. It's well known that he took the first option and became celebrated for it as the bulbous-nosed, bibulous comic icon people either love or hate.
"Someday you'll drown in a vat of whiskey."
"Vat of whiskey? Death, where is thy sting? I was in love with a beautiful blonde once, dear. She drove me to drink. That's the one thing I'm indebted to her for."
So how did his larger-than-life character get that way? William Claude, he hated the name Claude, Dukenfield, was born in Philadelphia in 1880, the son of an immigrant British greengrocer who'd married an American girl. He visited a local theatre at the age of 15 and was so impressed by the juggler that he started practising with his father's fruit and vegetables. He soon developed a juggling act good enough to get him a few local bookings. By 1896, the youngster signed his first professional contract to work in vaudeville. He changed his name to the less unwieldy W.C. Fields, and once he'd added his own style of comedy to the act, he became a bill topper and was in demand by all the major theatres.
"Were you ever a play actor?"
"My dear, last night that I appeared in Punka City, the house was so crowded, they couldn't applaud that way. They had to applaud this way."
"Oh, how wonderful."
"Nothing really. In Keokuk one night, they were so jammed in they couldn't laugh. Ha, ha, ha. They had to laugh. Ho, ho, ho."
I once played a theatre that was so packed the audience couldn't laugh or clap. Or at least that's what my agent told me. In March 1901, Fields made his first overseas tour, opening at London's Palace Theatre. One magazine praised him as a new and clever turn. And he soon became a favourite over here, billed as the greatest of eccentric jugglers or the silent humorist. I was interested to learn that he appeared at the Hackney Empire in London several times before America entered the First War. I played the Hackney Empire myself when it reopened again.